So thank you very much, sir, for your precious time for this wonderful interview with you. You have had a distinguished career in police force. How would you sum up your career?
Well, I had 38 years in the IPS, and after my training in Mount Abu, those days it was Mount Abu, now it's National Police Academy at Hyderabad. So I had started my training of the state in Maharashtra in Satara district. Then I had many postings, different places, and Bombay I had a fairly nice career worth remembering. That was the traffic branch, where I was the traffic chief of Bombay. And when we joined, I first became DCP, the youngest DCP traffic in 79.
Okay.
We were in a, where we have IB Chowan Pratisthan. So these are hutments, you know, old barracks where our office was housed. Hardly I think 27 cars and jeeps and a few motorcycles. And later on, we got it built to a beautiful headquarter. And with the latest technology, we were able to break into too many changes. Earlier, it was only traffic control. We put size in the traffic control to make it traffic management.
Okay.
So that is how I look at. Then I had a fairly, though it was a very brief inning, in Amaravati, where I was SP of the district for about 6-7 months. But a city, a district known, notorious for communal riots every week, we brought sanity in the system. And I'm proud to say that for the first time in India, when TADA Act was, you know, enacted, I was the first to introduce it in communal riot in Amaravati, and that brought sanity for all the years to come. And I don't think Amaravati since 87 has witnessed any communal incident. It has all got over. That is a good 6 months, and I even now the love they give me. I will know whenever transferred out of Amaravati, and because I was being promoted, so about 3-4 thousand with band, and they pulled me and my wife in a jeep, you know, Captain the Mutual Care, right, for 3-3.5 kilometers up to Bandera railway station. The entire first class coach was, you know, decorated with not many flowers and too many things, you know, as if we were a honeymoon couple. So I have some excellent memories. And thereafter, I again came to traffic. When I promoted there again, they upgraded the post, and I had again very memorable career, because quite a few things which I learned, we were able to bring in. And Mr. Sharapuwar that way was very visionary and dynamic, so he allowed me full freedom. Then I started writing many books. In my first earlier career, I'm actually basically from Roorkee University.
Okay.
I did my MSc, Physics with Electronic Specialization. And in 1970, I joined IPS. So when I was at DCP traffic, when the post was only of DCP rank, so we were associated with the World Bank people also, so not many changes they brought in. And then in the later year, when I became additional commissioner, the post also got upgraded. So we had a very different, you know, scenario. Then I, even when I was a traffic chief of Bombay, I was given a additional responsibility when post Babri Masjid, you know, demolition, communal riots, you know, erupted in Mumbai. So I was in charge of entire eastern suburbs. So those 2 months, December 92 and January 93, I cannot really erase from my memories. I saw the humanity, I don't know what we call, Vaishipan. There was nothing like insaniyat, you know. That was a very sad moment. I see people burning each other. everything I saw that was had a lasting impression on my. We try to then bring harmony by writing some shares and then try to counsel the people, and to a fairly good extent we succeeded. Especially we arranged not many relief and rehabilitation program with the help of all communities. That was a great success. Later on I got promoted as IG Traffic Maharashtra State. So there, of course, it was the first time the post was for the entire state was created. So I had to build an institution from scrap. Then in the old custom house we built that organization. Then the entire state we had to build organization professionally. Did it. I was then I was made Joint CP Law and Order Bombay. Those are very difficult period. Mendonca as police commissioner and I as Joint CP Law and Order. We were asked to join the same day. We were told in the morning we had to take over in the afternoon because a lot of mafia had become very active. They were killing people. People had stopped performing expensive marriages or buying, you know, high-end cars or buying flats because they would get a threat from some Dubai, somewhere from Malaysia and some Bangkok and that kind of thing. And those are days when Shri Krishna report was also getting politicized and so there were elections also. So those 2 year period was a very stormy period, but I am proud to say that we displayed courage and confidence and we were able to overcome the situation and brought sanity, and mafia was absolutely eradicated. Nearly eradicated, not absolutely. And Shivanandan at Joint CP Crime also joined us in the later part of those 2 years. So it was a very good team and we did reasonably well, I think. Then I became director. I asked for a change for some personal reasons because I was not happy with somebody. I just said, I don't want to work here. So then I went as director of the Maharashtra Police Academy at Nashik. So that was again a very memorable period, very memorable period. When without budget, without any finances, we were able to make the academy perhaps the best training institute in India, only by taking help of various well-wishers, top corporates who had a lot of faith in me. They gave money and I gave them my wisdom, experience, and didn't betray. Then I was brought in as additional DG training for the entire Maharashtra state. And then I was made Commissioner Intelligence, Maharashtra state. Again, a very major responsibility. That was the time when the major responsibility had started in a very big way. Very sensitive job where you are the head of security and intelligence for the whole state. And then I became police commissioner. Then our DG Anti-Corruption Bureau. And I had to take some unpleasant decisions and pick up some people. Even I had to arrest one DG rank officer. Law is the same for everybody. And then I was made the DG of the Maharashtra state. That was a very memorable thing because I had a fairly long meaning as DG of the 200,000 force, 2 lakh force. And in 2005 only, when I became DG, within a few months only, I was given one additional responsibility of the development of Nanded region.
Okay.
Because in 2008, some 300-year celebration of six, the first time of its kind in the world, was to be organize. So I was given that responsibility in addition to my regular work. So I had hardly time because there were no flights. So every 10 days I used to go from office straight to the railway station, 9 o'clock night time train, getting at 8:45, then again picking up 7 o'clock evening train, coming 7 in the morning back to Bombay, and those kind of things. I kept doing it. Taxing, but a good learning and very lot of satisfaction. So when I retired in 2008, I was accorded the status of DGP for another 3 years. Because I was made the administrator of the 14 historical Gurdwaras and under JNNRUM for chief coordinator for the development of the region. So that was a very different kind of working where you were developing the infrastructure and also. So we were able to make Nanded, which was a sleeping city, we brought it into a vibrant mode and made it a city of tomorrow. A tourism center, and the time has proved. Then I requested the chief minister that I'd like to call it a day now. So then I became corporate advisor. Presently I'm the chairman of many companies and director of many boards, and also corporate advisor. And so having an associate with many NGOs, so I'm happy man. Good physically, okay, mentally okay, I can still smile.
Great. So that's the best part.
That. I think I narrated the whole story
journey
of
from
my life.
Beginning till
yes.
now.
Yes.
That's great. Okay. You have been very vocal about social issues. What according to you is ailing our country today?
The where we have gone down and we are shy of telling openly is, I'll say my priorities are 3-4. Number one is we have fractured the communal harmony in the country. We divided the entire country on caste basis.
Right, that's true.
Whether it is Mandal, whether it's Ayodhya, whether it's Babri or anything, we all are responsible, some actively and some by remaining silent. I am one of them, but then I being in the service couldn't open my mouth.
Right.
But now I feel bad. I was offered by many parties, you know, to get to take a ticket. I just refused because I don't want to do that. I am cursing, you know, I am abusing so and so and he is abusing me. This is not elections. This is not election. This is not dignity. You become MP, you become Prime Minister, you become Chief Minister, anything, but you cannot do it at the cost of national dignity and national esteem. We have failed there very miserably. Again, 2 days back somebody saying in the private sector we'll have so and so cost basis and so and so. I think there should be no place for anything, whether communal, religious, anything. I may be wearing a turban. That's my choice. But I'm an Indian.
Right.
Sikh come much later. So I think we all have to understand it, that don't play with the system. People don't want it. People want their stomach to be okay, full. They should get proper food. They should have shelter, they want education, they want their health to improve. They want the basic necessities. Then comes religion and caste. Everybody the same. See, when you have sunlight falling, does it distinguish between Brahman and Dalit?
No.
When rain falls, does it say who is Hindu, who is Muslim?
No.
Same way the child is born, same way we go. I am inhaling breath, exhaled by you, and I am exhaling breath which he is inhaling. When we are sharing our breath, how can anybody be high and low or different cause, different religion, on this basis, very, very, God has not made it that way. Same blood group A, B, A, B, O. So, same from womb to tomb, the journey the same. We cannot be different, we all are one. We should be good Indians and above all good human beings. So, I believe in the concept of universal brotherhood, where there is no nothing, no space, however small. But religion and caste are personal things. Caste, because you are born there, it's not your fault. Law of probability could have been that I would have been born in, I could have also been taken birth in a Dalit family in Dharavi. It's not my earning. It just happened. And how does it matter? And religion is only giving you a Lakshman Rekha. It's sort of self-discipline that you have to follow this system. Now you are wearing white shirt, he's wearing blue. You are having your own, it's not just to provide a direction so that you remain within that orbit. So I follow some value system. Mm-hmm. But to say my religion is the best and yours is smaller, yours is the best, that's ridiculous. All are same. God is one. God is just one. These politicians must learn and they should not play on that caste and religion. Everybody is our own. That we must understand. Sometimes I discuss it. The sweeper, what work he does, we should be grateful to him what kind of work he is doing. We should be eternally grateful to him. How can we condemn him? Shame.
So that is the basic problem which is ailing the country. We should not...
Religion and caste, we are dividing the nation just to capture some votes. Mm-hmm. And that is one thing which is irking me, which is hurting me. Or individually, some of us are very good people, but as a nation, we fail to have national character. I always give an example. In 1945, when there was a catastrophe in Japan after the atom bomb in Hiroshima Nagasaki, two Indians were traveling in a train. They couldn't get anything to eat. So they were sulking and telling one local man, "Oh, we have heard so much about your country." One 12-year-old boy was listening to their conversation. When the Nagoya station came, the boy got down, came back with eatables, offered to the Indian, "Would like to purchase it?" He said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "But it's very expensive." He said, "No, it's blackmailing." "Okay, fine, tell me how many years, we are very hungry." He said, "The price is when you go back to India, do not tell that nothing was available in Japan." This is called national character. I bought a watch in Tokyo. I was about to pay when, just typical, they said, "Give the guarantee card." The salesman told me, "Sir, the entire country is a guarantee." This is called national confidence. Unless we have that kind of enshrined in us, all the things are very, very, how can you use this thing? The difference between China and India is, in China, with population, they have converted every human being with two hands. In India, on the contrary, we have one human being means one stomach. They are having two hands, we are having one stomach. And we want to keep only stomachs, parasites, so that we only give them free food, free this thing, everything, in the name of religion, caste, whatever you want to say. Garibi hatao, and then only ask after 5 years for the vote. I think that must go. So we have to do certain things if we really want to excel. Otherwise, the posterity is not going to pardon us. I can assure you that the way we have lost our national esteem and reputation, credibility, I think if we don't take cognizance of the truth, writing on the wall, I think as a nation we can't stand for a long time. Earlier we realized the better for all of us.
Okay. So, please.
Yeah, you keep taking, eating and asking, no issue.
No problem. Okay. So, with India set to become the youngest nation in world, what is your advice to the youth?
Say again.
With India set to become the youngest nation in the world, with more and more youth getting into business or entrepreneurship.
Oh, that way. Okay.
Yeah. So, what is your advice to the youth of the nation?
Number one is, follow your conscience and forget the history. Go for a future with courage, commitment and confidence. We always tell them character is a combination of 8 C's. C for clarity. You first must understand what you want. Once it's clear, then you should have a conviction for it. C for conviction. Then the third C will be C for commitment. Once you got a conviction, you must have commitment.
Right.
Then you must have courage. Then you must have confidence. And then is the coordination. C for coordination. Nobody is an island entire to himself. Everybody is a part of the same island. Therefore, thinking that what I thought, what I am committed to is the best, that may not be true. So, check up with others. So, once you have done that coordination, then the next C is correction. That means whatever you have learned from others, you fine tune your ideas. And the last is compassion. Show compassion. So, these 8 C's form the character. And character, when everybody has, each of us has, then it only become national character. And that is more important. So I'll tell the youth that don't go by what the top politician says. We should do what is good for the country, right, and other thing will follow automatically. You can't go wrong.
That's good. Do you think India has not done enough to actively encourage entrepreneurship amongst the youth?
Yes, we have not done it because we only try to politicize the youth just for the vote, so that after 18 they can vote for you. Even in the colleges, instead of having student councils, you have made the students into election scenario, which is not good because that divides. Council is where you select amongst yourself amicably. So consensus, give this man can be our leader. Like when with Roorkee, we did not have any elections. The senior most person was, we were called class senior. The highest marks wala was made the representative of the class. That's how they used to be, used to represent. And something of that kind, you know, where, you see, we have not harnessed the potential of the youth. Reason is, we have not given them good value system. We have taught them all wrong thing just to suit us, our own things, for our own some vested interest. We have not let them build that courage and that truthful attitude. So the attitude toward life is very different. You see, ultimately, everybody learns from how you act. How you do, through your action, the child learns, as Herbert Parker had mentioned, that we are not doing it.
Right.
So, we tell somebody, but our actions speak to the contrary. So the man loses confidence. You say, he's a liar. He's a liar.
Right.
And that is where we have gone wrong. So I think the youth has to be brought on the correct track, given full freedom, but otherwise, if the country can be really brought out of these shackles, it's only through the youth, because you still have better integrity. And today's youth, I find, they are less religion and caste conscious. And they also believe in national character because they are disillusioned with the politicians, the political leaders class. So now they want to do something different as nationalist. So this is the right time to strike chord and make them understand and lead them on the correct path. But unfortunately, when some leaders try to introduce a movement, the leader themselves lose their way. They become overambitious or they get across something. So then the entire movement again fall, the credibility goes down. I think we have to restore the credibility of the political system. Not that all politicians are bad, there have been very, very good people.
Right.
Let's give those examples and let them emulate. But then it has to start from the higher level.
So my last question to you, in what ways can the youth of India contribute more towards its economic and social growth?
Well, I think one thing is the youth, instead of squandering money of the parents here and there, they must understand money comes through toil. So whatever money you get, part some of it for good cause, for social causes, pick up some causes. No, I am chairman of a national committee on bravery awards and all that. So this year we have introduced one more award, that is of social commitment. We selected one teenager who with his friends the last few years have been doing something very different. So this year all Diwali money, all New Year money, all that he went to the elderly's elder home, took some balloons and eatables. He went to the mental hospital, gave them. So I think instead of allowing the energy to dissipate, they should know, they come as one and conserve the resources, respect the time, punctuality, and must understand that tomorrow is theirs. So if they want to preserve a good tomorrow, then today has to be taken care of. See, we should be like ice. The past of ice is water, the future of ice is water. We should behave like that. So I think they must participate actively in the social welfare schemes. Some youngsters can go teach not so fortunate children. Let them spend 2 hours a week. Let them go. Let them help the local police. No begging at the junctions. Proper discipline. See, things go like that. It's a beginning. You have to make the first step, second step, however small it may be, but better than zero.
Right.
So I think that is how then they get more confidence and more encouragement to take up many things. So this is how we should go.
So one small request, your interview or our conversation is incomplete without a great shayari. So if you can just give a great shayari for the entrepreneurs so that they can motivate themselves.
I'll give two.
That's great.
One on just to say communal and caste I were talking about. Muslim ko कुरान में इमाम ना मिला, हिंदू को गीता में भगवान ना मिला, उस इंसान को खुदा क्या खाक मिलेगा जिस इंसान को इंसान में इंसान ना मिला। दूसरा है टू द यूथ, भंवर से लड़ो लहरों से उलझो, कब तक चलोगे किनारे किनारे, सोच बदलो सितारे बदल जाएंगे, नजर बदलो नजारे बदल जाएंगे, कश्ती बदलने की